Hey, my name is Cameron, and I'm in Tampa, Florida, and welcome to The Difference, the place where we encounter the one who makes the difference in our lives. I'm here to tell you just a little bit about what to expect today. We'll have a quick message, followed by a few songs, and then we'll leave you with some next steps as we close out. Keep in mind, this is actually our third episode, so if you've missed the first two episodes in our Rooted series, be sure to go online to Facebook and catch up. We do want to connect with you, so if you have some time, drop down in the comments, let us know where you're watching from, tag a friend, or if you want to, you can send us a personal message as well. We're excited to have you with us, and I'm really pumped about what we have for today. So if you will, let's pray together and then watch our video today. Let's pray. God, we love you and thank you for this opportunity for us to come together, gathered from all different places, times, and just learn a little bit about you. See how you can make the difference in our lives. And so God, I just pray as we watch this video that you would be with us, that we would hear your words, and God, that you would allow us to see the difference that you can make. In Jesus' name I pray, amen.
So we are in a series called Rooted, where we're talking about how we can root ourselves in the truth of who God is and in His Word. And last week we talked about how to root ourselves in an intimate relationship with Jesus. This week we're going to be talking about how to be rooted in a heart of worship. And what I'd like for you guys to do as we begin this week is to go ahead and get a pen and a piece of paper. If you have to pause the video right now, go do that and then come back. And what I'd like for you guys to do is when you get that pen and paper, I want you to write down five priorities in your life. Five of the things that are most important to you, the things that you most value, the things that you invest in most highly when it comes to your time, when it comes to your energy, to your resources. What are your top five priorities? So now that you have those written down, I want us to go to our scripture today, where God is going to reveal to us what needs to be our top priorities in our lives. And we're going to hear how God fights for the hearts and the minds of His children to make sure that He is that top priority. So let's go into our scripture today, which is in Exodus chapter 20, verses 1 through 6. And what we're going to be reading here is the start of the Ten Commandments. Some of you guys have probably heard these statements. We often see them, thou shalt not do this, thou shalt not do that. As a parent, really my favorite of the Ten Commandments has always been honor your father and mother. That is the one that I think I have most often quoted in the last several years anyway. But today we're going to take a look at just the first two of these Ten Commandments. So let's go ahead and dig in. In chapter 20, verse 1, he says this, "Then God gave the people all these instructions. I am the Lord your God who rescued you from the land of Egypt, the place of your slavery. You must not have any other God but me. You must not make for yourself an idol of any kind or an image of anything in the heavens or on the earth or in the sea. You must not bow down to them or worship them. For I, the Lord your God, am a jealous God who will not tolerate your affection for any other gods. I lay the sins of the parents upon their children. The entire family is affected, even children in the third and fourth generations of those who reject me. But I lavish unfailing love for 1,000 generations on those who love me and obey my commands." I think it's really interesting the way that God starts those Ten Commandments. He starts them by claiming and reminding the Israelites who He is and what He has done for them. You know, it's so interesting because He says, "I am the Lord your God who rescued you from the land of Egypt, the place of your slavery." He's referring to a specific place and time that that he showed the Israelites his power and his mighty nature and the way that he cares for them and the way that he leads them. He could have used any example in history up until this point. He could have said, I am the Lord your God who created the heavens and the earth. Or, I am the Lord your God, the father of Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, Joseph. I am the Lord your God who rescued Noah in the ark. He could have said any of those examples, but he chose to use the example of the time that the Hebrew people were slaves in Egypt. And so I think that this is really significant in these Ten Commandments. So what we're going to do is we're going to go back and look at that story just briefly to figure out, okay, why did God reference that before he talked about these first two commandments, that we are to have no other gods before him and we are not to make idols or worship anything else but him. So we're going to scoot back in the book of Exodus to chapter 5. And let me give you a little bit of background as to what's happening at this point. So in chapter 5, we pick up with a guy named Moses and Aaron, and they're having a conversation with Pharaoh, who is the ruler of Egypt at this time. Now, Moses and Aaron's people, the Israelites, had been enslaved to the Egyptian people for 400 years now. 400 years of slavery, 400 years of injustice, 400 years of being under the rule and government and under the thumb and being abused and taken advantage of and enslaved to the Egyptian people. Now, when you think about 400 years, that's, you know, 6-7 generations of people by this point that had gone through. This was just their normal way of life. They had become accustomed to living as slaves in this foreign land. All of the priorities that people had, you know, 500 years ago when they were living as God's people had totally been washed away, and they had adopted new priorities, new ways of worshiping, and they had new things that were important to them as they spent their lives in service of Pharaoh and these people. And so this is where we pick up with this story. God has just told Moses and Aaron to go to Pharaoh and to let the people go so they could worship him. And this is the beginning of that story. In verse 1, chapter 5, after this presentation to Israel's leaders, Moses and Aaron went and spoke to Pharaoh. They told him, this is what the Lord, the God of Israel, says, let my people go so they may hold a festival in my honor in the wilderness. And that festival was their act of worship. Is that so? Retorted Pharaoh. And who is the Lord? Why should I listen to him and let Israel go? I don't know the Lord, and I will not let Israel go. But Aaron and Moses persisted. The God of the Hebrews has met with us, they declared, so let us take a 3-day journey into the wilderness so we can offer sacrifices to the Lord our God. If we don't, he will kill us with a plague or with the sword. Pharaoh replied, Moses and Aaron, why are you distracting the people from their tasks? Get back to work. Look, there are many of your people in the land, and you are stopping them from their work. So after 400 years of slavery, Moses and Aaron hear from God that God wants his people back with him, that he has had enough. They are worshiping idols, and it's because they don't even know any better at this point. After 400 years, they have forgotten that God is their priority, that he is the one that they are to worship. And so God has had enough, and he's about to show Pharaoh that he is enough. And so what happens in the preceding chapters that follow is that he ends up sending 10 plagues to the land of Egypt and to Pharaoh. And these 10 plagues are basically a showdown and a judgment against these different gods in Egypt that the people are worshiping. So we go through, and there are all these different plagues. He starts with the plague of blood, which was a judgment against the god, the goddess, and the guardian of the Nile, which turned the entire Nile into blood and just absolutely devastated the economy. And then he moves on, when Pharaoh won't let the people go again, he moves on to a plague of frogs. And this is basically a showdown against this frog-headed goddess of birth, that they believed the frogs were sacred, and so they wouldn't kill the frogs, so there were just rotting frog corpses all over the place. And God was saying, hey, I can defeat this god. And then he moves on, and he continues to knock down all of these gods that they serve. You have a plague of gnats, which was against the god of the desert. You have a plague of flies, which was against the fly god. You have a plague against livestock that was representing these gods and goddesses that were represented in the shape and the manifestation of cows. And you have so many of these gods that God is just knocking down one after another. You have a plague of festering boils, and then a plague of hail, a plague of locusts. All of these were represented by different gods and goddesses and guardians that the people of Egypt were worshiping. And God just took them out one after the other. And then, even after all of that, when Pharaoh still would not let those people go, God gets more personal. And here's what happens next. The next plague is a plague of darkness. And here's the interesting thing about this plague of darkness. It was actually to battle against the sun god Re, which the people believed was representative of the Pharaoh himself. And then the next plague is the one that was the most severe. It was a plague of death of Egypt's firstborn children. And that was against Isis, which was the protector of children. And after all of those plagues, Pharaoh finally said, yes, you may go. You may go and worship your God. So we come back to these first two commandments. You must not have any other God but me. You must not make for yourself an idol of any kind or any image. So my question to all of us today is this. What are your priorities? Because anything you place in priority over God becomes an idol. It may not be in the form of a gnat or the form of a fly or a locust, but if you put the majority of your time, your energy, your talents, your finances toward your work, toward your spouse, toward getting the popularity that you desire, toward success in life, or gaining more and more material things, those things have become an idol. And God, just like he knocked down the idols of the people in the Old Testament, he loves each and every one of us enough to knock down the idols in our own lives. So what are those idols? What are those priorities that you are placing ahead of your relationship with God? Go ahead and identify them and use this as an opportunity to say, God, I am reorganizing my life and I am putting you first. Because here's the difference that this makes in your life. We worship what we prioritize. Worship is not just about singing worship songs at a church service or in the car as you're driving. Worship is not just about coming to church or watching church online or listening to a pastor give a talk. Worship is the way that you lead your life when God is the priority and everything else is done in submission to him. We worship what we prioritize. What are you prioritizing? What are you worshiping? Let's pray. Heavenly Father, please work in our hearts and minds. Please help us to reorganize our priorities so that you are first. And Father, we ask that in your love and in your mercy, that you knock down those other things in our lives that threaten to pull our eyes and our minds and our ears off of you, Father, because we know out of your love for us that you love us enough to knock down the idols that we have set up in our lives. Father, help us be rooted in a heart of worship that is in response to the priority that we place on you in our lives. In your name I pray, amen.
With a thousand tongues to lift one sound, and then from north to south and east to west, we hear Christ be magnified. Where the host echoing is imminent, His name would burst from sea and sky, and from river to the mountain top, we hear Christ be magnified. And oh, Christ be magnified, let His praise arise. Christ be magnified in me. Oh, Christ be magnified from the altar of my life. Christ be magnified in me. When every creature finds its inmost melody, and every human heart is made of pride, golden and white and right, should hymn of praise, we sing Christ be magnified. And oh, Christ be magnified, let His praise arise. Christ be magnified in me. Oh, Christ be magnified, the author of my life. Christ be magnified in me. Oh, Christ be magnified. And I won't bow to idols. I'll sing song and worship you. And if it puts me in the fire, I'll rejoice because you're the truth. I won't be formed by fear. I'll hold fast to what is true. Cause the cross brings transformation. Then I'll be crucified with you. Cause death is just a doorway into resurrection life. And if I join you in your suffering, then I'll join you when you rise. Cause when you return in glory, all the angels and the saints, my heart will still be singing, my song will be the same. Oh, Christ be magnified. Let
We worship what we prioritize. Anne's challenge this week was for us to look at our lives and understand what our priorities are. What things may be ahead of your relationship with God? Where things may be a little out of place? It's important for us to make sure that our priorities align and are rooted in the one true God. If you have questions about tonight's episode, please join us for Sunday Night Live. Basically, you can just leave your questions or comments down below in the comments, or message them to us in a direct message, and we'll actually answer these questions Sunday night at 7 o'clock on Facebook, of course. And if you have anybody that you'd like to share this message with, or invite into The Difference to watch our next episode, please share that on Facebook. We'd love to have them join us. Thanks again for joining us this week, and I can't wait to see you for the next episode of The Difference. Hope you have a good week.